was born in Prague, in Czechoslovakia. It was still a communist country when I was born. You have no right, absolutely not, to anything. You didn't even have a right to own anything. It teaches you that the truth is not always welcome, that you can't just blindly, naively trust everybody. You're pretty much alone. You're very careful about who you let in your life. That mistrust that's been ingrained in you since early age, it's there. All these authors were writing about adventures. Then I realized, okay, well, I have to create my own adventures. And I strongly felt this need that I had to leave. It was the desire to explore, desire to breathe freely. Finally, I'm living the adventure instead of just reading about it. Painting for me is a need for self-expression. There's really nothing between me and the expression itself. I'm able to channel the energy from me, from my hands. It comes from within directly onto the canvas without having to use any tool. What I gain from being able to paint is this calmness. If I was not able to express myself this way, I would become really edgy and panicky. Much like that feeling that I had when I was younger, when I knew I had to leave. This time around, it's this voice telling me that I have to paint. For the first time in my life, I feel like I actually own it. I'm in control of it.
Hi, I'm Kristine Ballard.
And I'm Melony Smirniotis.
And welcome to ArtnUp, the place where creatives connect, cultivate, and support each other's artistic journey.
So today we welcome MAXIM. He is a contemporary artist from California.
Hi, MAXIM.
Hi, guys. Hello. How are you?
Well, should I say based in LA?
It doesn't matter. LA.
It's all foreign to us.
Okay, it's Los Angeles. Right downtown, like DTLA, actually. That's my handler, too, like MAXIM DTLA. So the downtown of LA is like a big thing for me. That's where it all started, really, for me. Really take off in a big way.
Were you always a creative person?
I have, yes. I always been creative. At least I think so. I mean, you know, I get bored easily, so I always have to come up with things to do. Otherwise, you know, my mind would go crazy. But yeah, I have. Yeah, it's with me. It started with music, actually, really, because it's the easiest. I think it's the easiest art form, or the most attainable art form for anyone at a very young age. You don't need really any education for that. You just need to have passion for it, love it, and then you learn as you go. So it was with my brother. I have a twin brother. He's a professional music composer. So he's stuck with it, and I switched to visual arts. But we started together playing music. We had this whole dream that we became really famous musicians, and it really actually happened for my brother. But derailed. And went a different direction. But music is still with me. I mean, like, I listen, like, in my studio, like, I always listen to music. Music is on 24/7, really, except for, you know, sleep at night. But otherwise, music is always on. It's stayed with me.
So, MAXIM, I read that you had an uncle and he had a studio, and that's the sort of get-go when you were a kid that sort of started the art process.
Oh yeah,
well, way back.
Well, my uncle, he was a painter. Back in, you know, the communist Czechoslovakia, being a painter, a professional painter, it was unheard of. People just weren't doing these things because it's just like wasn't a way of making a living, but he really was. And he had an attic studio in Prague. right, in the historical quarters of the city. And I don't remember much from those times because, you know, it was little, but I remember that place. I remember the distinct smell of the oil paints and turpentine, and because that was so new to us, like different to us. We didn't have that at home at that point. Later on in life, we did, but my dad then got into painting as well himself, just as a hobby, but he was actually really good. But my uncle, he was a professional painter his whole life. And that's where I got my first taste of it, so to speak. You know, I just remember he was painting this giant canvas, paintings like giant canvases. I mean, now when I look at them, they're smaller than mine now. But back when I was a kid, they were giant. And then the attic was, the studio was full of them. Like they were stuck on and everywhere. And I actually loved it. It was like a maze made out of paintings. And then each one, like, you know, as a kid, you have this very, like your imagination is just like, that's really all you have. And you run wild with it. And it's just, I don't know. I remember playing with my brother, like, you know, in the studio, just sort of running around and getting lost in it. And then sometimes you just like, you know, in your mind, you create this entire world out of these pieces that he had there. And just, he was a figurative, I mean, but not really. He was kind of like an abstract figurative painter. So it was, you know, like the proportions were a little off, but like kind of like Pablo Picasso, so to speak. I mean, he's still, you know, painted figures, but really distorted in a way. But his was, he had a different style. But yeah, so you could actually, you know, you see people in it, and then you see whatever you wanted to see, because of the abstract part, it was just all left to your imagination at that point.
That's so interesting. So interesting, because I think of images that I've seen with you in the studio, and that's quite similar to the imagery, you know.
Sounds like you're describing yourself.
Yeah, it does.
So was that when you were a child, Maxim, was that when you decided to be, you know, an artist? Did you decide, like, I want to be an artist for my life, or was it later on?
Yeah, I mean, you know what? I don't think this is something that people really decide. I mean, I think it's decided for you a long time before you even realize that's what you have. And, no, of course not. When I was a kid, I wanted to be a pilot. I wanted to be all these sorts of things. I didn't really think of the practicality of things at all. But like, I wanted to be an artist. I wanted to be a musician, first of all, I remember that. And it was like early teens, really, like maybe 11, 12, 13, something like that. When you start hitting puberty, and that was really, and my brother and I really had always had this really strong drive. And so for me, and for him as well, whatever we decide to do and we set out to do, we never do it halfway. We always have to go full in. And this goes for all aspects in my life. Not just professional or artistic, just in all aspects. So I knew at that point that I wanted to I just don't want to go to an office, or I want to be a worker. I just wanted to be something creative, right? I wanted to be an artist. But what kind of artist? I had no concept. They came later when, like, at the age of 15, I actually got accepted to an art school in Prague. And then that's where it really kind of, you know, that was the where I learned everything about letterpress, some photography, some painting, but calligraphy and colors and all this stuff. It was a really good time in my life. I remember, like, I had such a blast. I actually loved going to school. Most kids my age, you know, they hated it, but I loved it. It was very, you know, free thinking, kind of a club, you know, more than a school.
That's an interesting thing that you just mentioned there, because it turns out that artists love learning and we love research. It's a bit like writers and musicians, I suppose. It's the exciting bit is the bit before you land on the canvas.
Totally. And as far as collecting, like, I don't really collect things. I think I just collect, like, thoughts, and then I try to, you know, I just try to remember as many. And, you know, as you said, like, with the research, everything, I think I spend way too much time on the internet just researching things that I really care about, like the universe or quantum physics and stuff that really I don't know. It's just, I'm not, they're not practical to me, but they really are, because I'm already thinking about my next series, my next collection. What's all gonna be about? And it's usually every single one of them is about something that I'm trying to understand. You know, it's something that I am trying to wrap my head around, and I want to tackle it. But the thing is, we receive with me, and that you can see it in my paintings, like with the lettering, with the calligraphy there, they're all recordings of the thoughts that happen in my mind, in my head at the moment in time where I'm actually painting that particular piece. So, but the thing is, the train of thought is so fast, it's way faster than my hand. So they're just like scrambled thoughts, words of really just as you have in the universe, like you are at a certain space at a certain time, and that's a possibility. Or you can possibly at the same time be over there. But everything is just a possibility. But once you observe it, or once you when you kind of, my observation is putting it on the canvas. That's how I observe the world around me. And thus I'm actually making my world a reality. Otherwise it would be just a possibility, you know? So, and with that, every single time, you know, I start a new piece or like a whole series of them, I already have kind of, well, I see the flight path. So it's like, you know, and it's a three-dimensional, it's not just like a road or anything. You can go, you know, get all different directions. But the thing is, I don't know like what's out, I don't know what's not even at the end, but I don't even know what's along the path, the road. So, and I'm discovering these little milestones, so to speak, like these little kind of a knots, you know, or like these little intersections on the way. And then I can go in a different way and in ways that I never actually even thought I would, you know, prior starting the process. And I find it absolutely like fascinating, you know, just paintings of sport, just creating leads me to places in my mind that I didn't even know that existed, or I don't know, like I would not be able, sometimes like, you know, I come back and to the studio and I see a painting I painted like last week or finished last week. Because usually it takes me a few months to paint, finish a piece. So that's why I work like so simultaneously on multiple pieces. And I look at it and it sort of almost seems foreign to me. Like I'm like, how did, like, and in a really good way. I mean, like, this is brilliant. Like, I would never, consciously, I would never make that line because it would be maybe too perfect. It would be too engineered and would definitely not fit, you know, the whole picture. And so I'm looking at it and I was like, if I didn't think of this line, then how did it even get there? Because to me, when I look at it, it doesn't look like it's mine. Do you know what I get? Like it just
I completely understand what you're saying, and even I can relate on so many levels. But what you're describing as well to me is like this infusion of your own past, present, and future accumulated and rolled together. And sometimes you see, look back. I know I look back at my work sometimes, think how or when or why, or you know, like there's every little tactile marking for me is a product of.
Yeah, like
thoughts and experiences, past,
some of the things I don't remember learning, you know, and like it's there. I was like, I don't remember learning this. How did I do that? And then, so, you know, kind of like tap into that. There's always, I love to work with the form, meaning the materials that I use. And like this current collection of series is very different from the previous one. I'm using completely different materials. And before I set out to create a new collection, I usually like dedicate a few months to a research, how I'm gonna like, I have an idea what I wanna do, but I just don't know how to play about it because I'm trying to always create. I know it's very difficult and maybe possibly even impossible to create anything brand new or original, but I always strive to do something that I haven't seen before.
Where do you do it?
Right.
Where do you work? Where do you create this work?
Well, I have two studios. Like I have one here in LA and I have one in Prague. And so when I'm most of, like I spent summers in Prague, like three, four months out of the year, 3 months usually. And so I keep the studio there. So I work out of that studio in Prague, but most of the time I'm here in LA working out of the studio here. I can just show you around like a little bit later, but.
That'd be great.
Yeah. But so, yeah, it's just, I don't know. It's just.
Maxim, do you think you produce differently in the different studios? I see a lot of your work has to do, well, for me, looking at it, there's a lot of vibrations through it. And a lot of your work is almost like the evidence of the act that you were just describing to us. It's a performance that you have with the canvas. And I'm just wondering, for me, when I'm traveling, the light in a space has a real impact on me, maybe because I'm a color freak, on the atmosphere of when you're creating, like the spaces. So is the space in LA different? It, clearly, it's different to the space in Prague. And having been to Prague a couple of decades ago, there's such a different sensation in the air of all places that you go to. Do you think that that has an impact on the work that you do, or is it that it really doesn't play a part?
Actually, a little bit of both, I'd say. So when I see, I was like with this new series, I came up with this technique that I have to follow certain steps, otherwise I would not reach that goal with the technique. So the steps don't change. The technique doesn't change. Unless actually sometimes I can find the materials that I find here, I cannot find them over there and vice versa. So like I have to make, like when I was working with powdered marble years ago, it was really difficult to find the same powdered marble that I was, and not only that, but also the polymers that I was mixing with, creating the matter. So I had to kind of change around the technique as well when I switched the studios. But other than that, like for example, with this technique I'm doing now, it's fine. I don't have to do that. But of course, yeah, it's a completely different space. Not only like the studio itself, but everything, the surroundings. So I do get inspiration from different, not sources, but it does affect me for sure. But I don't actually really think it affects me that much. So if I were to go to Sydney now and paint a series in Sydney, I don't think it would look that much different.
Yeah. I have to ask you.
The thing is, like, what does affect me? It does affect me personally, but I don't think I don't think it affects the work that I do actually as much.
Interesting. Tell me, how do you schedule your time? Like, what does your week look like?
Okay. I have no idea. this is the thing. With me, and I'm finding it a little bit more difficult now because I actually used to live downtown. Now I don't live downtown, I live on the beach. So I used to be walking distance to my studio. So my process is very organic and spontaneous. I don't schedule anything. So I'm here every day, but the hours can vary. One day I can be here for 10 hours. One day I can be here for a couple hours. It really depends. So I don't really have a schedule. One thing that I'm certain of is once I get going, I completely lost, track of time. And then, and sometimes, just realize it's dark outside or it's just, I haven't eaten for the whole day. I haven't even had a sip of water. Like it's crazy. It gets just kind of mental like that. But sometimes I come here and do the technical activities work, stretching, prepping, cutting, because I do everything myself.
Maybe Maxim, you could tell us, walk us through a little bit of the materials that you use, because we can see it back there.
It's all secret.
You just mentioned a few different.
I'm very secretive about my process, but no, I'll let you.
I don't want to know the process. We just want to watch the materials.
No, I know.
Using now.
Yeah. So what's really cool, actually, now it's because the part of downtown where my studio is called the fashion district. So all around me are fashion designers and also wholesale shops with fabric. So I'm right in the middle of fabric bonanza. And I should have actually done it a long time ago, but I don't know, I was just so stuck with using or artistic grade linen. I only use linen, I don't use canvas anymore. It's just linen. Linen or I'll get to it later. But then I have a couple of friends here in the building that are fashion designers, and we hang out, and I was like checking out their fabrics then. And it got me to a point where I'm like, okay, I'm gonna try to do something different. So I started actually shopping around for fashion grade linen and cotton. So linen and cotton that you use to like create clothes, but like very fine. Like, so now I got it down, like my supplier, and like, it's fantastic. I don't think I will touch artistic grade. I mean, I don't want to say never, but for a long time. Because I get so much variety now just to begin with. Like I don't even touch it yet. And I already like have something different, you know, that like I see a huge potential. You know, some of the, like I have four pieces over there. I work on loose canvas. I stretch it at the end. So that gives me a huge freedom too, like to work with it, to do whatever I want with it. And I use tacks, I tack it to my wall. And there's a four of them right there. They're pink, like really fine pastel pink color. And it's very lightweight cotton mixed with linen. And it's almost, it's like see-through, and it's fantastic. And I never prime my canvas or linen. So I never do that. So I love the way it, the fabrics, and each one of them soaks up the pigment and the binders and water differently. And then here to the right, to me, there's four paintings that are on little thicker linen, but it's pre-washed, so it's very soft, and it's light blue. So like I just that gives me and then in the corner over there, like there are two canvases, two linens that are black, actually. They're not black anymore, but they were black. And then you can start like, you know, doing like negative space and reversing your painting process by just starting with black. And I absolutely love that. So again, always love to work with the form, like my previous collection, like the one, a couple of collections back, I was mixing this metal, like, so I would take powdered marble, mix it with polymers, create this like, you know, kind of really thicker than molasses, you know, matter. And then I would pour it on the canvas. And then as it would dry, I would form it, I would shape it, I would cut into it. And then, you know, over the course of, depending on the humidity and the heat, but like, you know, 7 weeks, I mean, 7 days, 2 weeks, it would completely harden and it would become marble again. So that was the way I was able to get marble on the canvas. Yeah, I made marble liquid and then let it, you know, become stone again. Yeah, it's just these processes, always looking at how I can, that's why I do so much research too, because like I want to do like the material, like different material, like what with resin, it wasn't, you know, I forgot, that wasn't for me. And plus it was overdone in the past too much. Even they have the artistic resin now that's like water-based, still wasn't really working out for me. I worked with, charcoal, but charcoal that's almost like big chunk of charcoal and ash, tar, all this stuff. I tried everything, but it's always like trial and error with every new series that I start. And I remember the marble series, it took me 6 months to come up with the process that I would be actually able to replicate for every painting of the series with the same results. And that was really difficult for me. This new technique is actually has a great effects, but it wasn't really as technically involved, or it wasn't as, there's not as much material involved in this.
Max, whatever yes. material you're using, it seems that tactility is really important to you, and you know, it's making contact, whether it's with your idea or whether you know your physical. And there's a lot of videos of you like that ability to touch it, and it is like that. You want to go up and touch your work. It's like, oh, and, yeah. and that that almost it's like a three-dimensional, and also when you combine the music with it, there's a pulse and a tactility about it. And even the way you're describing it, your energy about that transcends into that work. I mean, you're one in the same, really, but it seems to be right down from the surface that you work on, that sort of ability to change in tactility and navigate a space. And that's a lot of the sort of abstract expressionists would agree with you, that the result is about it from a conversation that you're having with an idea. And that tactility is really important, whatever material that you use. Is that, would that be right?
Yeah, right on. It's just, the thing is, every single painting is really, to me, it's like a physical exercise as well. I get like, you know, when I'm done at the studio every day, like I'm just exhausted. And it's not because, like, you know, I'm on my feet, I'm running around, like, you know, my canvases are large, so I have to go up and down. It's not even that. It's just mentally exhausted, that, and physically as well, in a way that, you know, almost you feel like you kind of cut a bit of yourself and just like you leave it there. So you, with every painting, not that you lose a bit yourself, you kind of give. It's like a, you know, it's like a, you are like a donor, you know, like, for, so to speak, for every painting.
I feel like it's like a beautiful exhaustion in a way. It's sort of bittersweet. But you do have an amazing energy, and especially when you talk about your work, it definitely translates. What happens though, Maxim, when you have days where you just don't have it, it's not working, you're not motivated, what do you do to counteract?
Well, first and foremost, I don't stress about it, because it just doesn't help the situation. It really doesn't happen to me. Anonymous, like you, unfortunately, it doesn't happen that I would come to the studio and I'm like, oh, I'm stuck. You know, like sometimes I finish a piece and I come back the next day and look at it, it's like, oh, it's nowhere close to finish. So I did, it's okay. You know, it was finished last night, but it was finished for that one day, for that one session. And I thought maybe perhaps it was finished for good, but it wasn't. You know, and I don't stress about it. So I go in and work. And then I realized maybe it just didn't even need that much work. It's just like, you know, I sit in this chair with this little thing, and I look at it. And then if I can figure it out, like, I know, like, look, it's difficult to describe. I don't have, especially with abstract paintings, people, I get this asked a lot of times, like, how do I know the piece is finished? But I know. Well, how I know, I don't know. I know, you know. And I look at it, and, like, I'm looking at a piece right in front of me. And I know it's there. There's something that's missing. It's a tiny little thing. But, you know, like, I'm not going to try to finish it today, because it's so, you know, so I have this piece of mine going back, you know, writing back on saying, oh, I finished that piece. No, because I know that I've been looking at it the whole time we're talking about it. I don't know what it is. So if I force it, I have to come back tomorrow and redo it, because I know that's not what it needed. That's a lesson that I've learned, you know.
Yeah, we have an artist, an Australian abstract artist called Jenny Sages, or Ada Tomescu, actually. Ada Tomescu is the strongest. And she says that when making works, because hers are very abstract, that it's like having a conversation with that work, and that when you stop talking to the painting, it's either done or it's dead. And it sounds, that's just what you illustrated to us, that conversation that keeps going, and then you get up in the morning and go, oh, it's not, I'm not finished talking to you yet.
That's true. And also, like, I know every time I go to bed at night and I'm thinking about that piece, I know it's not finished. You know, when I lie down and I don't think about it, I know it's done. Just like you're saying, you probably just stop talking. So the conversation is over.
Yeah.
But I know, I'm looking at it, there's something just, and I know exactly, see, the thing is, I pinpoint the area. I know exactly where, but I just don't know what it, I want to make it shut up. And I don't know exactly what it makes it shut up. But I know, see, there's the thing, I already know where, you know, where it is. And if I, like, sit here with whoever, like any given person, to them probably wouldn't make any, like, I'm gonna go and put one line, like, that's it.
That's interesting that you say that, Maxim, because a lot of people think that artists sit in their studio and they're alone, and it's solitary and it's quiet and they're alone. We are not alone. And you just explained that. It's like, we're really busy talking to what we're doing. Oh, yeah.
And you know what's so funny? Silence. I bring it at home and I didn't even know about it. It's just recently, like, my wife told me that she heard me talking to someone in the bathroom.
Yeah.
I was just like, you know, like I was taking showers, getting ready for bed. And I was and I had no idea. And she's like, you know what? You've been always doing it. It's like never really, I mean, this is what you do.
Oh, I can relate.
And I'm like, honestly, I have no idea. I thought in the beginning, I thought she was just like, you know, she was getting in my chain, she was making fun, but whatever, it's just for fun. But I guess sometimes it just like slips and actually I make a sound.
I think that's great, Maxim, because they often say artists are in their own little world. It's a pretty good place to be most of the time.
Oh, no,
but I'm, you forget, I'm, maybe you make I'm sounds.
Yeah, I wouldn't change it for a world. You know?
I'm happy to be there too. I never left, I think, once I entered. Tell us about social media. How do you tackle social media? How important is it to you? And how much time do you spend?
It's a good question because it's, you know, it's very important. It's way more important than I actually... Okay, I'm, you know, I don't... That's one area I should definitely improve, okay? Let's put it that way. It's very important. It actually works for me as well. Every single time I get on it and I'm diligent about it, it takes time. It doesn't happen overnight, but not that much time. I start seeing results. So I know it works. I don't know. It's just not my thing, you know? It's just, I do it because I have to. I don't overdo it. I don't really enjoy it. Not that I hate it. I don't. It's very indifferent to it. It's something that needs to be done. Something that, first of all, like when I use social media, I use it actively. It means I'm producing content. I rarely, very rarely actually consume social media. That means like I'm not on Instagram watching what other people are doing because I don't really give a damn, you know. Like I stay in contact with my friends through social media, but mostly like, you know, through like texts and FaceTime, because I have friends all over the world, and then, you know, it's difficult to, you know, I don't get to, especially, you know, what happened last year with the pandemic, everything, I don't get to see people as much as I used to. And we used to travel a lot, you know, my wife and I, and something that we were left doing, and something that actually I draw inspiration from too, it's just going places I've never been before.
In saying that though, with the social media, you do have a lot of collaboration with music and like cinematography in your own work. So if anyone goes to Maxim's website, you will see some spectacular moving action things. So you do spend a lot of time on that. And your collaboration with your brother.
Differentiate between social media as Instagram, Facebook, and my website. Actually, my website is a main tool for me, and I do it all myself. I learned from scratch. And actually I do enjoy that because that's kind of like my portfolio. That's my business card. So before I give anyone my handler for my Instagram, I give them my website. And I also think it's more professional too. And it can, like, the website can handle way more than just the Instagram. And also, like, you know, if Facebook one day decides that they're gonna, you know, shut it down, then, you know, at least I'll have that. I'll have my website. So I do actually work with my website, and I try to update that periodically, and that I don't mind. I do enjoy that. Because I know, like, if someone gets to my website, they're there for a reason, and they're probably going to see the things that I wanted to see. With the Instagram, it's just, you know, it's an instant flash, and like the effort I would have to put into. I mean, I'm sure it would be good, but eventually, maybe I'll have people help me with that. You know what? I don't know. But
So. I think they make some, when you look at your website, it does give a great sense of personality, shall we say, about the way that you get to control and put things together. You get, you've got up there too your beautiful collaboration with your brother Spoken, which is where this sort of mixture of creatives come together. If anyone's ever seen sort of Brian Eno and his brother Roger do, they did a series called Mixing Colors, and they combined music and art together. And this is similar to your Spoken, multimedia sensory show. It's really great because I think it can grab. Abstract art is sometimes a hard sell, and coming in from different edges can often get people's attention. And I think that that sort of has helped show a more dimensional side to your work, which then lets people start to digest what you're trying to do.
Well, also, like as I said, as I mentioned in the beginning, music as an art form is, to me at least, it's the most approachable art form, really. It's for everyone, and you see, fine art is kind of a snobby thing. It's not for everyone, you know. You have to and abstract painting on top of it is just like people, like, you know, majority of people just look at us like, I could do this like in 2 hours, or I whatever, like I don't see anything, it's just, it's crap, whatever. So that's, I don't know, it's a really hard piece to tackle, but music, everyone understands music. It doesn't matter age, gender, nationality, doesn't really matter. Music is really, it's just universal. And so to combine that art form with something that's really kind of sometimes for a lot of people difficult to not only understand, but to even digest, I think it would bring people closer. And especially when you see my brother's music, the thing is, it all started with my brother like releasing this album, Spoken, and I did the whole visual part of it with the logo, everything. And then we got this idea that maybe we could actually do something really intertwined, like have the music kind of describe what people see in a way. The paintings I made, I actually learned how to animate them in the computer. So I'm animating these paintings, and my brother's putting the sound effects to it, and there's gonna be the music from the Spoken album playing with it. And I think maybe the audible clues, the help, the guide will help people understand maybe there's, you know, with the abstract paintings, there's more to it than just like some random brush strokes or some random lane of colors, or just, to people like seem way too random, you know. So, but they have to understand that if they were to, you know, go really in the core of everything here in the universe, like sub molecular, subatomic, you know, kind of a realm, then everything just seems like a total random chaos, which is not though, because with the, you know, random chaos can create beautiful things like, you know, the life on our planet, you know, which doesn't seem that way.
And I think, Maxim, what you're referring to there in music is that it's almost the music and the art together. The music gives it a pulse. And like it, when you're teaching art, it's rhythm and repetition, and that you're seeing those patterns in music. And you listen to a sound vibe and it goes up and down. It feels like it's that vibration as well. And so those connections of vibrations through the senses is what you're talking about, whether it's visual or audio, is this pulse that comes through your work. And that urgency that we always talk about, it's like, I've got to tell you a story and I don't know what it is and I don't know the language, but I'm going to put it through in paint and maybe you can see it. And it gives a three-dimensional space. And I think that's what's so engaging about it. It's a space. It's a place we haven't been to before. And that's that emotional connection that we all want to make with a work, or as we're doing the work, our own work, or a space. And I think that's the combination is what it sort of provides a platform for, and that is what makes it so successful for others to understand, or a way in, let's say, a way in.
Yeah, like to bring it a little closer to people. And also, like, the other thing is to do a show like that, not necessarily in like a gallery setting, because like galleries are like, you know, people just, some people just say, I just don't go to galleries. It's too, it's sterile, and it's not for me. You know, it's for the highbrow folks.
So what is this?
But it's not true, really.
Maxim,
so like,
what is the setting, and how long is the show on for?
Well, so these are things that we still, you know, the show will kick off in Prague, like sometimes, like, you know, like second half of next year. The setting, it needs to be a space that's going to be big enough to accommodate all the pieces we're going to have there, because the animations are going to be projected on these huge light boxes that are going to be ginormous. And those are going to be accompanied by like regular paintings that I'm going to make. I think I'm going to do like 16 of them. They're going to be on the perimeter, outer walls of the space. But in the space, right in the middle of it, standing on their own, standalone, they're going to be these huge light boxes with the projections on them, with the animations. So we have to find the proper space for that, and we're talking to certain partners that we want to partner up with that will help us to make this a reality. So we're gonna do one in Prague, then we're gonna do one in LA we're gonna have the Czech consulate here in LA to be a partner of that show as well, and then they have outreach to certain cultural and art kind of communities here in LA. We're thinking about talking to Bergamo, which is in Santa Monica, which is this huge kind of a art facility. And then, so we want to, this is going to go on the road. So we're going to bring it, like our idea to bring it around the world. Like, you know, we'd love to go to, you know, come to Sydney. We'd love to go to Mexico City. We'd love to do New York, London, Paris, whatever we can, you know, do. And it's, I believe like we're going to have maybe 2 or 3 set up, you know, prior, and then we're just going to do, I think it's going to snowball. And especially if we get the consulates and embassies, the Czech embassies around the world behind it, then they could work and really make it a kind of a traveling world tour, you know. So we'll see. That's the ambitions with the ambition. Hopefully, you know, the world won't go all cuckoo again. So I don't know. It's really hard to, we were talking about earlier, it's really hard to plan everything, you know, to a detail. But, you know, it just teaches us to kind of, you know, be flexible and you know, just be ready. You know, the thing is, like, we have to be ready. So if it happens tomorrow, I have to be ready.
What is the hardest thing about being an artist right now?
Honestly, the hardest thing is just to make a living, really. It really is. You know, like, I don't think being an, like, once you're really an artist, and look, artists, it's such a, like a highbrow thing, you know, to say about, like, oh, I'm an artist, people are like, oh, whatever. I don't think once you really it, you know it, and you don't really, when you do it for the real, for the right reasons, for the passion of it, for the fact that if you weren't doing it, you die, because it's just like breathing to you, then you're okay. You don't have to worry about being an artist. It's going to be a hard thing for you, as far as the creative part. Unfortunately, the world we live in, it's not all about that. You know, we all have to kind of live pretty much, you know, the same life. I mean, we have to pay bills, you have to eat, you know, stuff like that. So, and especially, you know, with the last year, everything that happened with, you know, galleries closed, art fairs closed, and it's really hard to sell your paintings out of your studio when you can't even get people in your studio because you are on lockdown. So, yeah, the hardest thing about being an artist is just to make a living, really.
Yes.
And again, you can't compromise. If you really want to go all the way, you have to go all the way in. Otherwise, yeah. It'll just be a hobby, and that's fine too. But not for me.
Yeah, it is about I suppose the air that you breathe is likened to your art journey. Many of us artists, I know that we're consumed by what we do, and that's what makes us all unique in our practice. What's the best part about being an artist or your art journey?
The freedom. It's just freedom. Like, I can do, look, I do whatever I want, and that's the best part of it. You know, that's it. I'm living the life that I set out for myself, like, according to me, the way I want. And of course, you know, I have responsibility as every other person, but I create my priorities. I create my schedule. There's no schedule, like, you know, my days are fully for me and my family and my work. It's not just, freedom. Seriously, it just comes back to that again. You know, just like freedom.
So Maxim, what would be one thing that you might recommend to others who are struggling to get more art in their life? You've clearly filled every space in your life with your art, but what would you recommend to other people who just really struggling to, they want to be more creative, or they want to be more around an art community, which is probably why we're making this. One thing that you might recommend to them.
Do you mean people that want to collect art, or people who want to create art?
They just want to be in art. They want more art around them. So, you know, how would you?
Well, okay, for people people who have no ambition to become an artist, I absolutely love and appreciate, and are essential to people like that, essential to us, are people who have appreciation for art without having the ambition to become an artist themselves. Maybe perhaps they think they don't have it in them, or maybe they just really enjoy art looking at. I don't want to have anything to do with, like, you know, for example, like, I don't want to be a baker, but I love a really good, like, you know, homemade bread. You know what I mean? Just like, or like a cake, whatever. I love carrot cake, but I just don't want to be a baker. I don't want to even make it, but I, you know, I love to eat. So the same with art. They like to tell, like, they consume, like, the consumers of art, but really those people who do it for the right reasons, again, you know, like, for the beauty, for the sake, like, because we need that in our lives. We need things that, I mean, you can buy art, but if I put it in a way, like, you can buy, you know what I mean? You can really, yes, we do put price on it, but it's priceless. Like, to me, every painting I make, it's priceless, you know? And if I could, like, I'd probably just collect all of my paintings for myself. But, like, I don't know, I don't know, it's just creating something beautiful. And if it's just beautiful for you, to you, and other people think it's totally out of crap, I don't care. As long as it fulfills you. And the same with art. It's, you know, no one says this is beautiful and this is not. I mean, it's like with good wine. It's like with wine. You know, I drink certain wine that you find a total swill. You wouldn't even touch it, but I like it. And you like wine that I'd be like, no, it's not. But it doesn't matter. You know, I like it, and it makes me feel good. Like, I enjoy it. The same with art. You know, I like certain art, and, you know, that's why there's so many different kinds of art. It's just like, you know, it's for everyone. And if you want to be more involved and in consuming art now, with, like, you know, the world hopefully maybe getting a better place and opening up, go see art, you know, be around it. And when you go to an opening night, meet the artist, talk to the artist, and try to understand maybe why they painted that particular piece they like. And maybe, you know, they'll, you and then the more you do it, the different artists and different, like, then you start kind of understanding in a different way. You start seeing it from their perspective, and you start seeing their reality. And then, thus, I think it'll help you to understand art, you know. And sometimes, you know, I even think that art doesn't really it doesn't have to be fully understood. You know, it's just like, as long as it speaks to you in certain way, even if it's negative, if you think, oh, it's just too dark, I don't like it, it already speaks to you. You know, the worst thing is when you put a person in front of your painting and they look at it, it's like, interesting. That's the worst thing. You know, like, oh yeah, it's interesting. This is like, you either made a really bad piece, or that person is just like not getting it, but that doesn't really matter. I mean, in abstract art, we have a little bit of a leeway because, oh, you can say, okay, you just, you know, he doesn't know, she doesn't understand. But if you do like figure it, painting, that is bad, you know. Like, but be a part of it, go see it, talk to the artist, you know. You don't necessarily have to buy and collect the art, but just by showing up, you know, that's a great, so great support.
MAXIM, would you take us for a little trip around your studio?
Absolutely. So this is the bottle of vodka here. But so this is what, like, so as I said, you know, I work on loose canvas and I do stretch it afterwards when I'm finished with it. So this piece is almost finished. It's not completely finished, but almost. It's almost there. So I don't know if you can see it well. I don't see much on you. So it looks like it's really 3D painting.
Yeah.
But if you actually go.
Wow, the detail.
It's completely flat. So yeah, this is my studio. This is where I was sitting. This is another piece. These are 9 feet by 6 feet.
What a difference. Again,
you know, and you go in and it's all flat. And there's the, you know, calligraphy. Like. I don't know how much you can see from this, but.
Yeah, we have a great view.
And then pieces that I'm working on, like they're not the, first, these are actually the other ones are just underpaintings.
That really, that's what you were describing, yeah, cotton.
See, this is the fashion grade linen I was talking about.
Oh.
You know, it's completely different properties than this is. See, this is regular linen, like artistic grade linen, and this is the fashion linen. This one is thicker. So then, no, this one is completely thick and coarse, and this one is pre-washed, but thicker than the next one I'll show you. So this is the blue one. These are just pieces that I quickly just, like, you know, show you, but they're not even. It's a image of mix. This is a green little wall.
Oh, and, yay, the green!
That's all I got. Hello. So, you like green?
Mm-hmm. It almost so
these
looks
are,
like
you know, these are like, again, these are like the first layers of the next one too. But as you can see, this is a very fine pre-wash. You can see my hand through the fabric. This is actually linen with cotton, and it's Italian. The blue one is actually, I think, American made, but this is Italian cotton with linen, and it's. It's really super light, and I'm gonna have it. Originally, I was not gonna actually stretch it, but I think I will. So, but I have a shop here in LA that does the stretching. It actually makes frames for me, stretcher bars, stretch frames, and then I think I'm gonna actually have them to stretch these for me as well, because I don't think I'll have enough time before my show in Mexico City this fall to stretch these myself. So, and then. You know, there's like some others, like old work that's wrapped up, and there's my little room. These are drums. You know, these are, you know, I still play drums here sometimes when I feel like it, and you know, I got music hooped up here. And this is actually, I'll show you outside. So this is downtown LA.
Wow, ventilation. Yeah.
Pretty like down here it's pretty industrial, as you can see, but yeah,
wow, amazing. What instruments does your brother play?
He's mostly piano. This is like his main instrument, but he does play a lot of it actually. Yeah, but he creates his music in a piano, and then, you know, transforms into different instruments. But he also, like, you know, Western music, and then he has professional, like, you know, say, like, trumpet players. But he does the spoken album we're talking about is actually it's an album of classical music. It's a modern classical music. So there's it's fantastic. You guys, when I get to I don't know, I'll switch the camera again.
Yeah.
Yes. Next time I'm in Sydney, I'll bring you a vinyl. It's got these two different vinyls. There's one for the American market, it's white, and then it's like white with black and red, and then the European is so black and rivers with white writing and. And they have different bonus tracks too. So
fantastic.
If you collect them, you want to have more.
Vinyls are very hip now. I live in a West area, and we actually have a record shop. Yeah, it's very cool. We are down the grungy area, and it's come back.
Yes, so this is very grungy too. Yeah. Well, actually, right, like a couple blocks from me that's where Skid Row starts. I don't know if you're familiar with the neighborhood of Skid Row.
Yeah.
So yeah, and actually, it was just. Couple months ago, there was this big article in, I believe it was New York Times. It was either Forbes or New York Times, I can't remember. And they were showing, I believe, like 20 most dangerous neighborhoods in the United States.
Mm-hmm.
I'm in the second most dangerous neighborhood in the whole of the United States.
Okay, not comforting. No, we need you around, so.
Look, yes, I mean, it's probably not like, but like, you have to keep your street smarts. It's like, you live in a city. I mean,
yeah,
you know, you can be all, who knows what Kristen's, you know, these studies together anyways. Probably like so suburban people, you know. Nothing against suburbia.
So if people want to connect to you and your story in this exhibition, what do you suggest? Website, follow you on Insta?
Both, yeah. Actually, my Instagram, the handler is MAXIM DTLA, so it's my first name, and DTLA is actually a name, like it's name of the neighborhood downtown LA, so it actually goes by DTLA. So I'm MAXIM DTLA, that's my handler on Instagram, and my website is actually MAXIMDTLA.com, one word, MAXIMDTLA.com. But if you actually look me up online, you can find me too, actually, if you put it in the Google.
We're very much looking forward to you coming to Sydney and sharing your journey.
Yeah, I can't wait to be back. Absolutely loved it there. So, hopefully, but it was just a couple of years ago, and it was so fun, and then I definitely want to be back. I absolutely love the place. Sydney, Melbourne, we went up to Keynes, and, you just really tapped into it. There's so much to see in Australia. I want to go to the west coast of Australia and, all of it. I heard Perth was beautiful too. So, never been to Darwin, Alice Springs. I want to go all over it,
We'll plan your trip for you.
That'll be fun.
Thank you so much for being on us.
Thank you guys.
Yes, thank you so much. Maxim. It's been very interesting and enlightening, and we're really excited to have you come here. But if not, for the time being, we'll just look at the website and
stalking
on Instagram.
You guys have to get out of lockdown first.
Oh, yeah. We'll just do that.
Yeah, do that, please.
One day at a time. Okay. Thanks so much.
You're welcome. Thank you so much, too. Appreciate it.
Thank you, Maxim.
Thank you. Bye, guys, now. Right. Talk to you later. Ciao.